Ja, einen wunderschönen guten Abend. Herzlich willkommen hier im Kino des Deutschen Filmmuseums. Ich bin jetzt Daniel Peiler. Ich bin einer der Kuratoren unserer aktuellen Sonderausstellung Kubricks 2001, 50 Jahre A Space Odyssey. Ich freue mich, dass Sie hierher gekommen sind, trotz des wunderbaren Frühlingswetters, das wir draußen haben. Und ich kann Ihnen jetzt schon versprechen, es lohnt sich auf jeden Fall, denn wir haben hier heute Abend wieder einen ganz großen Gast zu Besuch, Peter Krämer, den ich Ihnen kurz vorstellen darf. Wie alle anderen Termine auch, finden Sie natürlich auch das heutige Programm im Flyer zur Ausstellung. Und ich darf auch noch mal darauf hinweisen, wir haben einen eigenen Flyer mit allen Begleitterminen. Die sind auch alle schon im Vorverkauf. Also wenn Sie sich jetzt schon für die eine oder andere Veranstaltung interessieren werden, dann können Sie jetzt schon Tickets an der Kinokasse lösen. Wir sind gestartet ja mit der Lichtinszenierung bei Stanley Kubrick schon Ende März mit einem Vortrag von Dr. Thomas Köbner, sind dazu übergegangen, uns am Osterwochenende rund um das Jubiläum damit zu beschäftigen, ja, wo kommt eigentlich das meiste Material aus unserer Ausstellung her, nämlich mit einem Vortrag von Richard Daniels, dem ehemaligen Stanley Kubrick-Chefarchivar von der University of the Arts in London, der die meisten Objekte ja für diese Ausstellung bereitgestellt hat, und hatten dann am Ostermontag zuletzt hier einen ganz wunderbaren Auftritt von David Zane Meyrowitz, dem Hörspielautor, mit der Aufführung seines Hörspiels Der Knochen. Und ich freue mich ganz besonders nach dieser Vorlage und nach dem Jubiläum, das wir hatten in der ersten Aprilwoche, denn nur um das nochmal in Erinnerung zu rufen, wir feiern 50 Jahre und die Uraufführung liegt jetzt genau 50 Jahre zurück. Am 2. April 1968 im Uptown Theater in Washington hatte Stanley Kubricks 2001 A Space Odyssey seine Uraufführung erlebt. Und nach dieser wunderbaren Vorlage der Premiere ist es natürlich geradezu zielführend, heute Abend jetzt sich damit auseinanderzusetzen, wie der Film denn von den Zuschauern aufgenommen wurde. Und darüber wird uns heute Abend Peter Krämer einiges erzählen rund um das Thema der Audiences, der Zuschauer von 2001. Ich darf Ihnen Peter Krämer kurz vorstellen. Peter Krämer ist Senior Fellow in der School of Art, Media und American Studies an der University of East Anglia in Norwich in Großbritannien. Und er ist einer der begnadetsten Kubrick-Forscher und Autoren. Er bereichert die Kubrick-Studies ganz wesentlich. Er hat Bücher vorgelegt zu Kubricks Vorgängerfilm vor 2001, also Dr. Strangelove or How I Learned to Stop Worrying and Love the Bomb. Da ist ein Einführungsband erschienen in der Reihe BFI Classics 2014. Er hat für die Serie Palgrave Controversies 2011 bereits ein Buch vorgelegt zu Kubricks Film nach 2001, A Clockwork Orange aus dem Jahr 1971. Und er hat eben auch, und das verdient natürlich besondere Erwähnung für unser Programm, den Einführungsband in der Reihe BFI Film Classics zu 2001 A Space Odyssey geschrieben. Der ist 2010 erstmals erschienen, liegt in der mittlerweile dritten Auflage vor und erfährt jetzt am 1. Mai eine vierte Auflage. Wir hätten Ihnen heute Abend gerne auch noch die Möglichkeit geboten, dass Peter Krämer Ihnen gleich ein Buch signiert, dass Sie das hier erwerben können. Aber leider sind wir gerade in einem Übergangsmoment. Der Verleger wechselt nämlich für diese ganze Reihe von BFI, vom British Film Institute. Und falls Sie Interesse an diesem Buch haben, wir können es Ihnen aufgrund dieses Wechsels jetzt im Moment nicht anbieten, aber dank der Hilfe von Peter Krämer und des Verlagshauses, das wird ab 1. Mai dann Bloomsbury sein, haben Sie die Möglichkeit, das Buch jetzt schon vorzubestellen in der neuesten Auflage, und der Verlag hat mir entsprechende Bestellzettel mitgegeben, und Peter Krämer freut sich natürlich, wenn Sie davon auch Gebrauch machen. Das heißt, ich gebe die jetzt mal durch. Und dann haben Sie im Idealfall Anfang Mai die neueste Auflage dieses Standardeinführungswerks. Ich kann das sehr ans Herz legen. Ich lege das meinen Studierenden auch in den Filmseminaren immer ans Herz. Es gibt kaum so gute englischsprachige Einführungsliteratur zur Darstellung von 2001. Noch ein weiteres Werk, das Peter Krämer veröffentlicht hat, möchte ich unbedingt erwähnen. Es ist ein Sammelband, den er mit herausgegeben hat, und zwar zusammen mit Tatjana Lucic und mit Richard Daniels, den wir ja zuletzt hier zu Gast hatten. Und die drei haben gemeinsam nämlich ein Band herausgegeben, Stanley Kubrick New Perspectives, der ist 2015 bei Black Dog Publishing erschienen. Ein wunderbares Buch, das nochmal neue Perspektiven auf Kubrick bietet und insbesondere auch von dem reichhaltigen Material Gebrauch macht, das in den Stanley Kubrick Archives an der Universität in London seit 2007 der Öffentlichkeit zugänglich ist. Ich freue mich ganz besonders, dass Peter Krämer heute Abend zu uns spricht und dass er auch einen Film ausgewählt hat, nämlich Stanley Kubricks zweiten Feature-Film, seinen zweiten Spielfilm, Killer's Kiss, der dann im Anschluss an den Vortrag und unsere Publikumsdiskussion laufen wird. Der Vortrag findet in englischer Sprache statt. Peter Krämer sagt dazu gleich noch etwas. Und wir haben im Anschluss die Möglichkeit, über das Gesehene und Gehörte noch zu diskutieren. Also, wenn Sie Fragen, Anmerkungen haben, das dann gerne auf Englisch und auf Deutsch. Jetzt aber erstmal Bühne frei für einen der ganz wichtigen Kubrick-Forscher, Peter Krämer. Herzlich willkommen.
Vielen Dank, Nils, für die Einführung und für die Einladung. Ich möchte zunächst mal was sagen darüber, warum ich den Vortrag auf Englisch halte. Ich bin zwar Hesse, aber lebe schon seit 30 Jahren in England. Und in dieser Zeit ist Englisch meine Fachsprache, meine Arbeitssprache geworden. Und es ist mir in den letzten Jahren zunehmend schwer gefallen, filmwissenschaftliche Vorträge auf Deutsch zu halten. Deshalb dieser Vortrag auf Englisch. Aber wie gesagt, die Diskussion kann auch auf Deutsch verlaufen. Nun zum eigentlichen Vortrag. The title of my presentation is 2001: A Space Odyssey and Its Audiences. But I should probably have called it 2001: A Space Odyssey and Its American Audiences. I want to start with the response of one particular American audience member, which I found among the many letters people sent to Stanley Kubrick after seeing 2001. These letters are now accessible in the Stanley Kubrick Archive at the University of the Arts, London. In July 1968, a young woman from Ohio declared in a letter to Kubrick, I quote, "Your movie, on me at least, has had the same effect as the monoliths pictured in the film had on the race of man." She described 2001 A Space Odyssey as, I quote, "a hand reaching down from destiny to help us on to better things." So like the monolith moving the hominids on to become modern humans and moving modern humans on to become whatever it is that we see at the end of the film itself in this woman's experience was utterly transformative. It was like a monolith working its magic on her. She also reported that her parents had, I quote, "liked the realism, the technology, but they complained of not being able to find a story." By contrast, it would seem the young woman did not mind the absence of conventional storytelling because she was able to focus on the overarching theme of transformation, which in her view applied both to what happens on screen and to what had happened to her in the auditorium. Many other Americans wrote to Kubrick identifying birth and rebirth as the true subjects of the movie, which they saw mirrored in their own experiences with 2001. Many declared themselves to have been changed in a profound way by the film. One man going so far as to ask, "How many times must I be born to realize what I am?" Kubrick's correspondents often acknowledged the difficulties they had with making sense of various aspects of the film, particular sequences of events, certain imagery, and so on. But most of them were able to rise to this challenge by developing their own, in some cases quite elaborate, interpretations, or by acknowledging that some things simply cannot and indeed need not be explained. In doing so, they referenced other films as well as a range of intellectual frameworks, psychoanalysis, myth scholarship, theology, philosophy, science, and so on. Thus, one man summarized people's responses which he had overheard. So this is one man writing about what he overheard other people say, either during the break or at the end of the film, when they had all seen it together. So I quote this man reporting. "These responses range all the way from, 'There was no story. The whole thing was a series of disconnected vignettes, just like the early Cinerama spectaculars. Two, it was about the Second Coming. Didn't you see the cross formed by the string of planets and that black thing? Christian and other religious or metaphysical ideas were mentioned in quite a few letters. One man reported on a discussion with friends which resulted in four distinct interpretations of the film, the fourth of which he labeled rebirth theory. In death, you come back to Earth as another living creature. And the pastor noted, the impression I carried with me as I left the theater was that life begins with the infinite, God, and it ends in the same manner. Judging by the letters Americans wrote to Kubrick after seeing 2001, the majority of viewers did not only enjoy the film, but were deeply moved and intellectually stimulated by it, taking away from it a sense of hope for their own future and that of all humanity. This was, I want to suggest, one of the main reasons for the film's surprising box office success in the United States. Now, if you've read anything about 2001, you know that it flopped with critics and audiences at the outset. That is the claim. The claim is that both critics and audiences rejected the film, and that it only became successful later on with young people, only with young people. Now, at the same time, this established literature often registers the enormous impact the film has had on viewers. Indeed, it is obvious that so many people have felt compelled to write about it precisely because of the deep impression it had made on them. This was certainly the case for me. Watching 2001, as well as Kubrick's Clockwork Orange, as a teenager in the late 70s at a cinema in Gießen, just 40 miles north of here, inspired me to become a film scholar, and eventually led me to dedicate a lot of time to research on these two films. I've been particularly interested in how audiences, including both regular cinema goers and reviewers, responded to 2001 when it was first released, and how successful the film was commercially. In this talk, I first present the results of my research into the film's success in the United States, before then trying to begin to explain this success with reference to its marketing, the film's marketing, and to major trends at the American box office, and also to link it to wider developments in American culture, very briefly. Let's start with the film's success. My examination of a wide range of primary sources, including reports in the film industry trade press, box office data, and letters people sent to Kubrick, has led me to conclude that 2001 was, contrary to received wisdom, a huge commercial hit with a cross-section of the American population from the outset. And also, except for a few often cited New York reviewers, a critical success. So I can't present all the evidence to you, but one of the most persistent claims about Kubrick's film, I think, is absolutely blatantly wrong, no matter how often it is repeated. The film was a success with critics and audiences in the United States from the outset. Now, in this context, it is important to note that the film was first presented in the United States from April 1968 onwards as a so-called roadshow, which meant that it would initially be shown on 70mm in a small number of cinemas with all the trappings of a night out at the theater, especially at the opera. Bookable seats, when normally you wouldn't book seats, you couldn't and you wouldn't, high ticket prices, an overture. Many of you might be confused when you watch the DVD or Blu-ray edition, which has the overture, and you think, what's going on? Why is there no image? Why do I hear 4 minutes of Ligeti at the beginning? Well, that's the overture. And roadshows had overtures. And an intermission, which is also reproduced now on most DVDs and Blu-rays. So this is a very special format for presenting a film, an extraordinarily prestigious way of presenting the film to the public. Only in 1969 would the 35mm version of the film, without overture and intermission, go on general release in regular cinemas at regular prices. Now, what is road showing? Why did they do this? Did they just do that for 2001 because it's such an extraordinarily special film? No. Road showing had long been the standard release format for Hollywood's most expensive and most prestigious productions. And in those days, actually, that was the same. The most expensive productions were also the most prestigious productions. That's not the case anymore today. But it was until the 60s. These road shows offered audiences a very special event outside their usual habit, or more commonly, non-habit of cinema going. Unlike regular film exhibition, which by the late 1960s was completely dominated by youth audiences, roadshows were rare occasions for the whole family to go to the cinema together. So that's very important. Yes, late 60s cinema going is all about youth, but not roadshows. Roadshows are the one or two occasions during the year when the whole family goes to the cinema together, dresses up, you know, because it's a special event. It's like going to the theater, going to the opera, paying a high price, booking in advance. You had to show up on time and so on. Very special event. Now, when you look at the publicity, advertising and merchandising for 2001, what you find is that quite successfully, it seems, a lot of this material appeals to children and their parents, and also to women, who Hollywood had traditionally regarded as the most important audience segment, although this was rapidly changing in the second half of the 1960s. 2001 was presented to the public as a super expensive, very prestigious release, which was addressed to everyone. Everyone should be able to enjoy this film. And even those people, like young children and their older parents, who rarely ever went to the cinema, would go to the cinema for a roadshow. 2001 stood apart from other roadshow attractions because it was a Cinerama presentation. In its original version, which used three cameras and three projectors, the Cinerama process had been the most spectacular of all the widescreen formats of the 50s. Way more spectacular than CinemaScope and such. However, after 1962, the Cinerama company discontinued this very complex and expensive process and instead licensed the major studios to use the Cinerama label for a very small number of single-strip 70mm productions, on average 2 to 3 per year, which were guaranteed a release in specially designed Cinerama theaters characterized by their huge curved screens. Thus, 2001 was initially shown in 1968 almost exclusively in Cinerama theaters. And I just learned from Niels and the exhibition that that was even the case in Frankfurt. The first showing of 2001 was in the Cinerama theater. In the United States, the film performed very well at the box office throughout 1968. It had an exceptionally large number of advance ticket sales before it was released. And by the end of the year, it had earned $8.5 million in rentals from only 125 cinemas and came 11th in the list of the top grossing films of 1968. So you must imagine that 200-300 films are released that year, but only 10 films made more money than 2001. And 2001 wasn't even on general release yet. It was only shown in as a roadshow in a small number of cinemas, 125 in this case. Once the film went on general release on 35mm and at regular prices in a much larger number of cinemas in 1969, it was able to reach those audiences who had not previously had a chance to buy tickets for it, and both these new audiences and some members of the original audience who came back to see the film again and again turned 2001 into a major hit. By the end of 1969, it had added another $6 million to its rentals. Taking into account the broad spectrum of people who wrote so positively to Kubrick about 2001 in the months after its release, and the fact that roadshows had traditionally appealed to all-encompassing family audiences, we can conclude that across 1968 and 1969, the film succeeded with most audience segments, rather than depending solely or mainly on the repeat attendance of youthful fans, who in any case were reported to have stayed away from 35mm screenings in 1969, because it wasn't spectacular enough, it wasn't psychedelic enough to watch it on 35mm. That was the claim. However, early on, the trade press began to focus its reporting on the presence of young people in the audience for 70mm screenings of 2001, on their special interest in the Stargate sequence and their allegedly widespread consumption of mind-altering drugs during screenings. And that's the story you will read in almost all books that cover 2001's belated success. That it was those people, young people under the influence of drugs watching the film again and again and again. And the reason for that is that the trade press started to pay attention, that some people did this. It is, I think, mainly in response to such reporting in the trade press, rather than in response to any actual audience research, that MGM eventually introduced a more psychedelic marketing campaign. So eventually, they changed from this kind of marketing to the ultimate trip with a star child spacily looking into the camera. But this only happened for the film's 70mm relaunch in April 1970, by which time 2001 had already been playing in cinemas for 2 years. Thus, irrespective of its close association with youth and the counterculture, 2001 was a massive hit with mainstream audiences. And I think if you want to take one provocative thought away from that, it was its year's Rogue One. Or Star Wars The Last Jedi. That was the status of this film. It was a massive hit with mainstream audiences. And I think that's something which is rather surprising, I think. And that's also why people continue to repeat the story that it wasn't. That it was only probably highly educated student, drug-taking, countercultural youth we could appreciate a film like that. That is not true. In the hundreds of letters that I examined, there's not a single letter from someone who could be characterized the way I just did. They're all from little children, from housewives, from pastors, from astronauts, from people from all walks of life. But not a single one from someone who said, oh, Spacey, great film. The film was also well received by critics. Except for a small number of leading New York reviewers whose work is repeatedly cited in support of arguments about the film's initial critical rejection. Yes, there were a few people who rejected it, and they're endlessly quoted, but they're a small minority. In fact, the leading film industry trade paper, Variety, reported in June 1968, I quote, "Almost all out-of-town and foreign reviews have been excellent, while those in New York were generally downbeat." Well, even in New York, that's not true. There appears to have been a largely positive reception, which escaped notice, even the notice of Variety, because good reviews were overshadowed by the attacks of a few high-profile critics. A 15-year-old fan of the film was so concerned about the lack of appreciation in some quarters of the critical community that, as he wrote to Kubrick, he kept, I quote, "A record of reviews that 2001 has received, mostly from New York publications. I am happy to announce that 33 are excellent, which is much more than the reviews that were not so good." So, another point to take away, all the claims that 2001 was rejected by critics generally is not true. It was a small minority of New York-based leading critics that rejected the film. The rest embraced it. The film was also listed as one of the 10 best English language films of 1968 by the National Board of Review. But, and that's quite interesting, at the end of 1968, the beginning of 1969, there was yet no agreement among critics that this wasn't just a good film, but this was one of the greatest films. So the National Board of Review said it's one of the 10 best films of 1968. But the New York Times, for example, did not include 2001 amongst its top 10. And the film received no awards from the National Society of Film Critics, the New York Film Critics, the Hollywood Foreign Press Association, the Writers Guild of America, or the Directors Guild. So it's a good film, but it's not outstandingly, massively huge and great in critics' estimation. While the Academy of Motion Picture Arts and Sciences nominated the film in 4 categories, including Best Director and Screenplay, it only won the Special Visual Effects Oscar. And by the way, the only Oscar that Stanley Kubrick ever won, and the one he least deserved, because the special effects team has claimed that they did the special effects, not Stanley Kubrick. And we can have a discussion about that if you want. It was not until the beginning of 1970, when various publications tried to determine the best films of the 1960s, that 2001 began to be recognized as a really outstanding masterpiece. While it did not appear in Time Magazine's top 10 list for the decade or the top 10 selection made by filmmakers in the Los Angeles Times poll, it was voted the 8th best movie, foreign or American, of the 1960s by readers of the Los Angeles Times. 2 years later, a general consensus about the film's status as one of the best films ever made seemed to have been reached. It took a while, it took a few years, but they got there in 1972. A panel of film producers and critics put together by the University of Southern California ranked 2001 10th in its list of, I quote, the most significant movies in American cinema history, which gave new concepts and advanced the art and technique of filmmaking. At the same time, in Sight and Sound's 1972 survey of international critical opinion, 2001 was included among the 25 best films ever made. By the early 1970s, 2001 had also become one of the highest grossing films ever at the American box office. The 70mm re-release in 1970, together with ongoing 35mm screenings that year, and further re-releases of the film in 1971 and 72, added more millions to its already impressive tally, so that by the end of 1972, it had passed the $20 million mark and was ranked among the 20 highest grossing films of all time in the United States. Its level of commercial success thus matching its level of critical recognition as one of the all-time greats. In the light of the film's radical departures from the conventions of Hollywood storytelling, the fact that it was hugely successful from the outset is, I admit, a rather surprising discovery. Let me briefly remind you of some of the unusual aspects of 2001: A Space Odyssey. Instead of following the actions of a single protagonist or group of protagonists, pursuing a well-defined set of goals, the film tells three different stories, each with their own protagonist or protagonists, whose goals are not always obvious. First, there are ape-like creatures or hominids who are difficult to tell apart from each other, and whose behavior can therefore be quite puzzling, to be honest. The film then follows a scientist traveling to the moon, whose motives for doing so are revealed only at the end of his journey, when the monolith is revealed. Afterwards, the film shows two astronauts on a spaceship to Jupiter. Once again, the reason for this mission is revealed only towards its end, when Haywood Floyd's pre-recorded message is being played. From Jupiter, one of the astronauts then goes on a further, utterly incomprehensible journey through space and time. Instead of outlining clearly how one thing leads to another, 2001 breaks down the cause and effect chain of events, both at the level of the film as a whole. It is, for example, difficult to determine, especially on first viewing, how its three stories are connected to each other, and at the level of individual scenes as well, such as the ending. It is often unclear how the events shown in the film are connected with each other. What is more, human agency seems to be fairly marginal in this film, because there are no humans in the first story at all, and even the pre-human hominids we see are being manipulated by a mysterious monolith. Similarly, most of the action in the second and third story is caused either by monoliths or by HAL, the computer. Humans are mostly responding to the interventions of these non-human agents, and the motivations of these non-human agents are never explained. So if the simplest definition of classical storytelling is a protagonist with a clearly defined goal pursues it, meets obstacles, and then either fails to achieve it, his objectives or not, then Kubrick's film fails fundamentally. But it goes further. Instead of selecting only those parts of an action that might be deemed relevant for the ongoing story or stories, much of the film consists of shots leisurely and meticulously depicting earthly landscapes or celestial formations, as well as the often very slow movement of people and spacecraft through these, with little or no concern for narrative progression. Hitchcock once said, "Film, or cinema, is life with the boring bits cut out, not 2001: A Space Odyssey." You see events unfolding without any regard whether it moves the story that is being told forward or not. How is it possible that this film could succeed with a mass audience? In order to explain its success, it is worth studying the ways in which the film was presented to prospective audiences in the United States in the run-up to and during its initial release in 1968. We can also examine how the film relates to the biggest hit movies of the preceding years, which the audiences of 2001 would have been familiar with. Indeed, like the film's marketing, these earlier hits would have shaped audience expectations for 2001. So what did they bring to the film that allowed them to enjoy this? Yeah, everyone, little children, six-year-old children wrote letters to Kubrick saying how great it was. Grannies wrote to Kubrick saying how great it was. How was this possible? So the marketing of the film and people's previous experiences with Hollywood's biggest hit movies, I think, help us to understand that because they were prepared for what they were going to see and experience. The release of 2001 in April 68 was preceded by more than 3 years of publicity and advertising. On 23rd of February 1965, the project that was to become 2001 had been officially announced to the press by MGM, the major Hollywood studio which was going to finance and distribute the film. Under the headline, Stanley Kubrick to film Journey Beyond the Stars in Cinerama for MGM, Journey Beyond the Stars being the project's original title, the studio's press release revolved around the filmmaker, whose statements accounted for much of the text. So when MGM announced the project, they really announced Kubrick's new project. In recent years, Kubrick had made 3 films, Spartacus, 1960, Lolita, 1962, and Dr. Strangelove, or How I Learned to Stop Worrying and Love the Bomb, 1964, which had been both commercially and critically successful. And he was widely considered to be one of the most important American filmmakers. But note, also one of the most successful at the box office. Now, Kubrick was a mainstream filmmaker with great success with general audiences. His last film, a comedy thriller about the outbreak of nuclear war, originally released in January 1964, less than 1.5 years after the Cuban Missile Crisis, had been regarded as an important contribution to the public debate about nuclear weapons, and was still playing in many American cinemas in February 1965, also receiving a lot of attention during the award season in the early months of that year, at the very time that MGM announced Kubrick's new project. Dr. Strangelove was very much in the press, in the media. Indeed, MGM's press release for Journey Beyond the Stars started by highlighting, I quote, the worldwide acclaim Kubrick had received for Dr. Strangelove and Lolita. The initial publicity was thus based on the assumption that the press and prospective cinema audiences would be familiar with Kubrick's name, or at least with the titles of his last 2 films, Lolita and Dr. Strangelove, and that they would be interested in the filmmaker's new project, in particular because, like Dr. Strangelove, it concerned a very topical subject. With a lot of excitement and debate surrounding the American attempt to realize the late John F. Kennedy's vision of landing a man on the moon by the end of the decade, the MGM press release quoted Kubrick as saying that his next film would offer a scientifically based depiction of space exploration at the beginning of the 21st century, such exploration being imagined as an experience, I quote, that will transform our civilization, not least because it involved an encounter with extraterrestrial intelligence. From the outset, then, publicity for Kubrick's forthcoming film promised to take audiences on a journey into the utterly unknown, a journey not just to the stars, but into an undefinable, mysterious beyond. This journey would be transformative, not only for the film's protagonists, but for human civilization as a whole. The first MGM press release was followed by a fair amount of media reporting across the next 3 years. Then, when the release date approached, MGM's marketing efforts were ramped up to such a degree that they were described by Variety as the most extensive, in-depth advertising, publicity, and promotional campaign in the studio's history. This is the studio that had released Gone with the Wind and Dr. Zhivago, but 2001 had the most extensive, in-depth campaign, marketing campaign, in the studio's whole history. That's what Variety said. This is not a little art movie. This is the biggest thing that Hollywood has to offer, and Hollywood wants to sell it to absolutely everyone. Indeed, in the months preceding and following the film's world premiere in Washington, D.C. on 2nd of April 68, 2001 was ubiquitous in the United States, with advertisements, reviews, and reports appearing in print and broadcast media, posters on billboards, trailers in cinemas, and lots of merchandise in shops. Tie-in products ranged from jewelry, presumably for the ladies, and toys, presumably for the kiddies, to a soundtrack album and Arthur C. Clarke's novel 2001 A Space Odyssey, which had been written parallel to the making of the film and was published a few months after its release. Upon entering one of the few cinemas showing 2001 in 1968, ticket buyers could purchase a souvenir program or a more extensive souvenir booklet, which was also available at bookstores and newsagents and by mail order. The drawings used on posters and in advertisements, as well as the shots selected from the film in trailers and the film stills reproduced in the souvenir booklet, positioned the viewer in space, often near a space station, in Earth orbit, that's the most common poster, on the moon or inside a spacecraft. The most extravagant advertisement for the film, a four-page spread combining drawings with a lot of text. That's four pages in major magazines. Four pages, just an advertisement for 2001, with lots of drawings and a lot of text. It invited American readers to project themselves into a futuristic scenario. Less than an hour ago, the text begins. You were rocketed up from New York's Kennedy Spaceport to embark on a journey that will take you into the far reaches of the universe. Your first stop is the slowly turning wheel of Space Station 1. The text then outlines in considerable detail, which emphasizes future technologies and their basis in contemporary science, a journey to the moon and on to Jupiter, pointing out that, I quote, even then, your journey will just be beginning. This is followed by a discussion of intelligent life elsewhere in the universe and the possibility that, I quote, long before the beginning of history, Earth may have had visitors. The advertisement then ends by announcing, in the mind-stretching finale, you find yourself hurtling through immense star clusters, past clouds of exploding gas where whole suns are being born, and on into strange regions of space and time where rage forces forever incomprehensible to man. And here at the end of your journey, you will meet the powers that watched over the birth of our species and have been waiting ever since for us to emerge from our planetary cradle. While it is, of course, impossible to determine what particular cinema goers knew about and expected from 2001 before watching it, between them, publicity, advertising, and merchandising for the film were likely to have impressed on them that the film would take the reality of the world they lived in, including the best available scientific knowledge about it, as its point of departure. That it would take them on a journey, transporting them in an intellectually challenging and sensually stimulating fashion into the future and into outer space. And that it would deal with transformative moments in human history and confront them with great mystery to do with godlike extraterrestrial powers. And I think that's exactly what 2001 delivers. So people didn't approach this film by thinking they're going to get a regular, classically told story about a hero who wants something, has some obstacles, and then gets it or fails to get it at the end. That was not their expectation. The expectation was that this is a science-based travelogue into space and time, which will be transformative, and it will also be mysterious. And that's exactly what they get in the film. And I think that helped them to enjoy the film, because they were really prepared by it, for it. But the film and its marketing also built on dominant trends at the American box office. Because you think what I just told you would be quite exceptional at the time. You know, you had to be specially prepared for 2001. But what I want to argue now is that, in actual fact, if you look at the biggest box office hits of the late 40s to the mid-1960s, what you get is a lot of these elements at the center of these previous hits, which would also have prepared audiences for the experience of watching 2001. Importantly, from MGM's first press release in 1965 to the posters and advertisements printed in 1968, 2001 was consistently described as an epic drama of adventure and exploration. The film's marketing thus referenced the exploratory nature of earlier Cinerama blockbusters, as well as the international adventures and historical epics which had dominated the US box office since the late 1940s. Let me go through this. Cinerama, international adventures, epics. And then I also talk a little bit about the most special form of epics. Some people might say they're not historical because they're not real. Those are the biblical epics. I'm going to go through how those types of films, which utterly dominated the box office, which anyone who at all went to the cinema would have seen, and especially the people who rarely went to the cinema would have only seen these kinds of films that I'm now talking about. The cinema would be for them Cinerama, travelogues, international adventures, historical epics, and especially biblical epics. That would have been the cinema for them. And I want to argue that those experiences prepared them very well for the experience of 2001. As a Cinerama release, 2001 was directly connected to a series of hit movies going back to the first Cinerama movie, This is Cinerama, from 1952. When Variety listed the highest-grossing films of all time in the United States in January 1968, a few months before 2001 was released, five Cinerama titles made it into the top 40. These were the three 1950s documentaries, This is Cinerama, Cinerama Holiday, and Seven Wonders of the World. The slapstick comedy and cross-country travelogue, It's a Mad, 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 Mad World, 1963, and the epic How the West Was Won, 1962, which is the highest-ranked Cinerama film at number 10 in the all-time chart. The original Cinerama films of the 1950s had been travelogues, taking audiences on journeys around the world without any overarching story being told. Later releases often combined frequently changing locations and attractive scenery with a story, for example, a racing competition. How the West Was Won tells the story of the westward expansion of the United States in a series of, in some cases, only loosely connected episodes. Since the most successful Cinerama films stayed in cinemas for many years, it is quite likely that they would have still been on people's minds during the time that 2001 was promoted as a Cinerama release, thus preparing them, once again, for an overwhelming audiovisual experience to do with a variety of spectacular sceneries, and also for a film which did not focus on telling a conventional story in a conventional fashion. Indeed, even the baffling Stargate sequence could be said to be a filmic element familiar from previous Cinerama releases, because most of them contain scenes such as the roller coaster ride in This is Cinerama, best trick in the world. Huge screen, put the camera at the front of a roller coaster and then go up and down. So most Cinerama releases had such scenes which focused on the camera's rapid forward movement, which had an exhilarating, even dizzying effect on viewers. So from a Cinerama release, you would expect something along the lines, maybe even of the Stargate sequence. Audiences' encounter with 2001 was also prepared for by the success of International Adventures, which told conventional stories with a strong emphasis on the attractions of frequently changing settings, thus also offering the pleasures of a travelogue. Variety's all-time chart of January 68 included, for example, Those Magnificent Men and Their Flying Machines, 1965, which is at number 29 of the all-time chart, and Around the World in 80 Days, 1956, as well as the James Bond films Goldfinger, 1964, and Thunderball, 1965, which was at number 9 in the all-time chart. Most importantly, perhaps, dealing with the very beginnings and a possible end to human history, 2001 was clearly linked to the cycle of movie epics, which told stories about momentous historical developments and had ruled the box office charts for the preceding two decades. The top 10 of Variety's all-time box office chart from January 68 included, in addition to How the West Was Won, films dealing with the Egyptian and Roman empires, Cleopatra, 63, the Russian Revolution and the subsequent Civil War, Dr. Zhivago, 65, the beginnings of Christianity, Ben-Hur, 59, the escape of the Israelites from Egypt, the Ten Commandments, 57, the American Civil War, Gone with the Wind, originally released in 1939 but making most of its money during re-releases from the 1950s onwards, and the rise of National Socialism. The Sound of Music, that's the American version of the Trapp Family, 1965 at number one in the all-time chart. audiences were thus used to deal with the overall shape of human history when going to see Hollywood's biggest releases, such as 2001. That's what they're programmed to expect. These are films about human history, about key moments, key developments, key turning points. And I would say that prepared them exceptionally well for 2001. Now, importantly, again, several of Hollywood's biggest hits of the post-war period, ranging from Samson and Delilah, 1949, Quo Vadis and The Robe, via The Ten Commandments and Ben-Hur, to The Bible in the Beginning, 1966, dealt with the profound mystery and impact of divine intervention into human history. Once again, it is worth noting that The Bible in the Beginning, similarly to How the West Was Won, told its story in the form of only loosely connected segments. So mystery is at the center of at least that particular cycle of films that people would have seen before they came to see 2001. Based on their previous cinema-going experiences, audiences came well prepared for the encounter with the mysteries presented in 2001, and also for the rather disconnected journey they were taken on by this film, and the transformative experiences in humanity's past and future it confronted them with. All of these, in retrospect, perhaps very unconventional, even avant-garde aspects of the film, were familiar to audiences from biblical and other historical epics, from international adventures and Cinerama travelogues. Of course, there's much more to be said about the reasons for the huge success of 2001: A Space Odyssey in American cinemas in the late 60s and early 70s, not least about the complex ways in which the film plays with audience expectations, both fulfilling and frustrating them, and sometimes fulfilling them through frustration. There's also the fact that this period in American history was, of course, characterized by dramatic cultural, social, and political change. This in many ways prepared the stage for 2001: A Space Odyssey's vision of humanity's rebirth, which, as pointed out earlier, was how many viewers made sense of the film. Against the backdrop of a rapidly changing world, the film was often understood as a promise and as a demonstration of human potential. The potential to change at the level of the individual, of particular societies, and of humanity as a whole. All of this is very evident in the letters that Kubrick received from regular cinema goers. So we could explore this in much more depth, and the exhibition actually begins to also set us on this train of thought in trying to explain where 2001 is coming from and how it could make such enormous impact at that time. However, I want to end this talk by going back to Kubrick's earlier film, Dr. Strangelove, and what it indirectly might have to tell us about the strong resonance 2001 had in American culture. Dr. Strangelove ends with the explosion of a nuclear doomsday device, which will destroy all human life on the surface of the Earth, with only a few people destined to survive in mineshafts. Stanley Kubrick was personally convinced, as he stated many times, both in public and in private, that nuclear self-destruction was humanity's likely fate. And according to various opinion polls, this view was shared by 1 to 2/3 of the American population. In a particularly revealing and indeed shocking mid-1960s survey of children, American children, psychologists, I quote, carefully avoiding any reference to the bomb or to war, simply asked these children, think about the world as it may be about 10 years from now. What are some of the ways in which it may be different from what it is today? More than 70%, 7 out of 10 children, 70% of a total of 350 youngsters, spontaneously mentioned the bomb, either by envisaging a gruesome existence underground or in terms of possible wholesale destruction. 70% of these children in that survey simply said there was no future for them at all, or one so miserable it might not be worth living in underground mine shafts. Unprovoked. It could be argued that Kubrick embarked on the production of 2001: A Space Odyssey precisely so as to offer a more optimistic vision of humanity's future. He didn't believe in it, but he thought, come on, what am I going to do? So he said, let's imagine a different future. Indeed, for a long time, the film was meant to have included many references to the threat of nuclear war, which, in terms of the film's story, could only be neutralized through space exploration and the intervention of extraterrestrial intelligence. While Kubrick removed these references from the film, they are discussed at length in Arthur C. Clarke's best-selling novel and also in the souvenir book for the film that could be purchased at cinemas. This book refers back to Dr. Strangelove as, I quote, one of the most unconventional films ever made, ending with the destruction of the world. And it explained, I quote, Kubrick is rather dubious about the ability of the human race to survive in the long run. He came to the conclusion that space exploration might be the only thing that the human race could learn to do, which would keep it from blowing itself up. So that's in the souvenir booklet that you would buy, maybe, when you go to the cinema and you read through it, and there it is. Several of the people writing to Kubrick after having seen 2001 referenced his earlier film, Dr. Strangelove. One of them declared, Dr. Strangelove was depressing, almost as depressing as 2001 was elative. Not sure whether that's a word, but you know what it means. It lifts you up. Another admirer of Kubrick's work described Dr. Strangelove as, I quote, the most hysterically precise expression of our lust for apocalypse ever given to the people. While 2001 was an exquisite tribute to the inexpressible life force, a touching portrait of ever innocent mankind. I want to suggest, then, that certainly the making, but also perhaps the reception and success of 2001 A Space Odyssey, had a lot to do with a widespread awareness of the possibility, even likelihood, that humanity would destroy itself on Earth. Not only through nuclear war, but also through a more gradual process of environmental destruction, an issue that the majority of Americans in public opinion surveys said they were increasingly concerned about from the late 1960s onwards. In the context of fears about humanity's self-destruction on Earth, Kubrick and his audience were inclined to look to the heavens so as to be able to imagine an alternative future. 2001 does indeed present godlike extraterrestrial beings or powers, not only as a creative force bringing humanity into existence, but also moving it on to a higher level of existence in the not-too-distant future. In doing so, however, the film does not necessarily want to be taken literally. And Kubrick certainly did not intend any straightforward message. We don't have to wait for higher powers to intervene and protect us from ourselves. Instead, I think, what the film shows us is that radical transformation is always a possibility. There is no need to wait for higher powers to intervene. What the film shows is that transformation is always a possibility. And the film also shows us what this transformation might feel like. Through watching the film, you feel what a transformation might be like. 2001 A Space Odyssey is not so much about a particular future for humankind, but about our ability to change. And that is how it was widely understood, and why I think it was so tremendously popular in the United States of the late 60s and early 70s. And it is also why we today, in the context of the renewed threat of nuclear war and the likelihood of catastrophic climate change in the not-too-distant future, should still pay close attention to this film. Thank you.
Gibt schon erste Reaktionen? Gerne.
Ja, vielen Dank. Ich hätte die Frage des oder die Thematik des Erfolges gerne mal in den Kontext der Kosten gesehen. Es gibt ein sehr schönes altes Heft, wo Cinefax, wo das nur dem 2001 gewidmet ist und da wird sehr elaboriert über die technische Konstruktion gesprochen. Ich habe das irgendwann mal versucht, zu damaligen Zeiten Preisen umzurechnen und bin auf ungefähr 200 Millionen Euro gekommen. Jetzt ist natürlich die Referenzen, müsste man jetzt auch in damaligen Preisen und inflationsbereinigt und so weiter sehen. Kann es sein, dass einfach der Erfolg zwar sehr groß war, aber die Kosten das Studio nicht fast in den Ruin getrieben hätten?
Das ist eine gute Bemerkung. Also ich rede immer vom Erfolg beim Publikum. Ob das ein wirtschaftlicher Erfolg ist, hängt von den Kosten ab. Und die Kosten waren 10,5 Millionen. Das war der siebenfache Preis von einem Durchschnittsfilm. Das kann man jetzt nicht direkt vergleichen. Der heutige Durchschnittsfilm kostet 75 Millionen. Siebenfaches. Kann man nicht direkt machen. Aber es war das siebenfache von einem Durchschnittsfilm. Und der Film hat tatsächlich keinen Profit für MGM gemacht bis in die 70er Jahre hinein. Aber mir geht es halt um den Erfolg beim Publikum, nicht um den wirtschaftlichen Erfolg. Die Kalkulation für wirtschaftlichen Erfolg ist sehr kompliziert, insbesondere weil man nie verlässliche Daten kriegt. Das ist einer der Gründe. Aber das war ein super, super toller Film. Er wurde zunächst für 6 Millionen, also im Februar 1965, sollte er 6 Millionen kosten. Das wäre viermal der Durchschnittspreis gewesen. Und dann hat sich das fast wieder verdoppelt. Also es war ein gewagtes Unternehmen. Und für mich ist natürlich das besonders Erstaunliche an dem Film ist, das ist eine absolute Superproduktion. Und der sollte auch viel konventioneller sein. Der Film sollte einen Prolog haben, wo Wissenschaftler in die Kamera reden und erklären, was es mit Evolution und mit außerirdischem Leben und mit Raumfahrt auf sich hat. Dann sollte der Film ein Voice-Over haben, wo der ganze Film über irgendjemand plappert und dir erklärt, was eigentlich vor sich geht, dann sollten da lange Dialogsequenzen drin sein, wo erklärt, warum Hall sich so verhält, wie er sich verhält. Und es sollte ein ganz normaler symphonischer Score sein, der extra für den Film komponiert wurde. Und in den letzten Wochen und Monaten, bevor der Film rauskam, hat Kubrick das alles rausgeschmissen. Und eigentlich hat Kubrick in dem Moment ein ungeheures Risiko eingegangen, weil er gesagt hat, das, was ich mit dem Film erreichen will, ist besser, wenn die Leute nichts verstehen. Also hat er alles rausgenommen, was in dem Film erklärt. Er hat aber Kompromisse gemacht. Also die erste Vorführung war ja 20 Minuten länger und dem fehlten zwei, drei Sachen. Bei der ersten Vorführung, und das hat Kubrick auch angemerkt, und hat dann noch gesagt, das war ein Fehler, ich bin zu weit gegangen. Also er hat 20 Minuten rausgenommen nach der ersten zwei Vorführungen oder so. Und dann hat er eben, wenn Moonwatcher die Idee kriegt, einen Knochen als Waffe zu benutzen, oder als Werkzeug zunächst mal als Waffe, da hat er reingeschnitten, ein Flashback zu dem Monolithen. Und außerdem hat er die zwei Titel eingeführt, Jupiter Mission 18 Months Later und Jupiter and Beyond the Infinite. Also das hat er nachträglich noch reingegangen. Also Kubrick war sich schon klar, ein bisschen was müssen die Leute verstehen. Die dürfen nicht die Orientierung völlig verlieren. Aber er hat in den Wochen und Monaten, bevor der Film rausgekommen ist, in einem super teuren Film alles getan, um den Film nach Normalverständnis so unattraktiv wie möglich zu machen. Aber nicht mit der Idee, einen Avantgarde-Film zu machen, sondern weil er glaubte, dass das die Leute anspricht. Und er hat recht gehabt. Und das Wunder ist, dass MGM ihm nicht dazwischen geredet hat. Dass MGM nicht gesagt hat, Leute, das ist unser Geld, wir müssen das Geld unbedingt wieder einnehmen, du machst das jetzt alles wieder anders. Denn Kubrick, wir wissen nicht, was die Vertragslage war, aber höchstwahrscheinlich hat er nicht Final Cut gehabt. Also MGM hätte den Film völlig umarbeiten können, aber das haben sie nicht gemacht. Und das ist eines der großen Wunder der Filmgeschichte. Denn Kubrick hatte recht. Er hatte recht, dass gerade das Mysteriöse an dem Film aufgrund der Sachen, die ich ein bisschen versucht habe zu erklären, durchaus in die Zeit passte, in die Erfahrungen der Kinozuschauer.
Ja, danke für die Frage, wo wir jetzt gerade bei den Kosten sind. Vielleicht auch nochmal, um das ein bisschen zu kontextualisieren, du hast es ja schon angerissen auch. MGM hat ja unglaublich lange an den Film geglaubt. Also nicht nur weit über dem Budget, eben von 6 auf 10,5 Millionen US-Dollar rauf bei den Produktionskosten. Der Film wurde ja auch 16 Monate später fertig als ursprünglich angekündigt. Und kannst du das nochmal ein bisschen kontextualisieren, Peter, vielleicht, weil du dich ja viel auch mit anderen Filmen des New Hollywood zu der Zeit auseinandergesetzt hast, in anderen Publikationen. Was war das für eine Umbruchssituation, dass so ein Studio, so ein Major-Studio wie MGM so lange, also 4 Jahre, Geld gegeben hat, Zeit gegeben hat und Kubrick vertraut hat, bis hin dann zu den 241 Walkouts bei der Premiere, also Leute, die vorzeitig den Saal verlassen haben, darunter ja auch viel geladenes Publikum von den MGM-Studio-Verantwortlichen. Also man hätte ja auch dann nach der Premiere noch sagen können, wir lassen den jetzt in der Versenkung verschwinden.
Also das ist eines der großen Rätsel. Ich hatte vorher auch immer gedacht, das hat was mit dem New Hollywood zu tun. Das glaube ich nicht. Es hat nur etwas damit zu tun, wahrscheinlich, dass MGM einfach interne Probleme hatte, die so ungeheuer groß waren, dass sie irgendwann gesagt haben, jetzt ist uns dieser Kubrick auch egal, der soll mal machen. Der hat drei Hits geliefert, vielleicht klappt es ja. Ich weiß es nicht. James Fenwick, der kommt doch auch im Juli, oder? Nee, der kommt nicht.
James Fenwick ist bei uns auf dem Symposium, genau.
Wir Symposium.
Genau, 21. 22. Juli, können Sie sich schon im Kalender ankreuzen, ja. Haben wir zwei Tage hier ganz viele weitere Kubrick-Forscher.
Und der ist eben der Mann, der sich in seiner Doktorarbeit, die ich lesen durfte, als Prüfer, auseinandergesetzt hat mit diesen ökonomischen Aspekten und welche Verträge man eventuell in den Archiven finden kann, aber auch welches Verständnis es wohl gab zwischen den Vertragsschließenden. Denn es geht nicht immer nur um den, was der Vertrag wirklich sagt, sondern wie er auch verstanden wird. Und den müsste man mal fragen. Also ich glaube nicht, dass er selbst in einer Doktorarbeit zu einer definitiven Antwort kommt. Es ist eine Mischung wohl an Gottvertrauen in Kubrick, an Verzweiflung über, dass man sowieso nächste Woche seinen Job verliert. Und dann auch, dass 1967 die Regeln für das Hollywood-Kino umgeschrieben worden sind. Aber deshalb hatte ich ursprünglich darüber nachgedacht. Weil da hatte ich noch geglaubt, dass halt 2001 ein Film für das Countercultural Jugendpublikum ist. Das glaube ich jetzt nicht mehr. Und MGM hatte natürlich gemerkt, dass 1967 Filme Riesenerfolge waren, die vorher überhaupt nicht gemacht werden konnten. Weil 1966 die Selbstzensur abgeschafft, nicht abgeschafft wurde, aber die wurde so geschwächt, dass sie praktisch keine Rolle mehr spielte, schon 1966. Und 1967 kamen halt super gewalttätige Filme wie Bonnie and Clyde und sehr explizite erotische, sexuelle Filme wie The Graduate, nicht nur ins Kino, sondern wurden gigantische Hits. Also MGM hat schon gemerkt, dass man mit anderen Filmen jetzt auch Gewinn machen kann. Aber ich glaube fast, dass es, weil MGM bis die letzten paar Wochen, Kubrick, die letzten paar Wochen, bevor der Film rauskam, sah der Film so radikal anders aus. Also ich beschreibe es manchmal wie ein Disney-artiger Film. Das sind so Tiere, die sich so wie Menschen verhalten. Und es wird halt, es gibt, Disney war der erfolgreichste Produzent von Science-Fiction-Filmen, Filmen über Wissenschaft. Disney hat Sachen für Fernsehen gemacht, über die Weltraumfahrt. Disney hat Filme über Tiere gemacht. Also es ist eigentlich eher, in der Entwicklungsphase war es eher so eine Art Disney-artiger Cinerama-Reisefilm im Weltraum auf Wissenschaft basierend und so weiter und so fort. Das sollte ja auch alles erklärt werden. Und ich glaube, alle diese Faktoren haben zusammengespielt, dass letztendlich keiner gesagt hat, das geht jetzt nicht, wir ändern das jetzt. Und da Kubrick sich kompromissbereit gezeigt hat, insofern als er nach diesen ersten problematischen Aufführungen tatsächlich den Film geändert hat, ich glaube, das hat viel geholfen, dass er selber gesagt hat, okay, ich bin zu weit gegangen, ich gebe es ja zu. Aber es ist eine interessante Frage weiterhin, was da im Detail abgelaufen ist. Denn für mich ist das große Wunder der Filmgeschichte, dass 2001 in dem Moment von dem Studio nicht gekillt wurde. In dem Moment kurz bevor er rausgekommen ist. Das ist eines der großen Wunder. Und irgendwie will ich auch an dem Mysterium festhalten. Irgendwo will ich es auch gar nicht erklärt haben.
Gibt es weitere Fragen oder Anmerkungen Ihrerseits? Ich komme zu Ihnen.
I think that maybe there is a second mystery also related to the fact that with the previous film, Dr. Strangelove, Kubrick was, I would say, in the blacklist for the U.S. government. They were not happy at all about the story. Mm-hmm. And also the U.S. Army was thinking it must have been somebody to have been giving a secret details about the plane. So it is strange to me that the next film, it is like it is heavily supported by NASA, for example.
Mm.
And that is also an aspect that maybe you can further explain how much of NASA is support and expertise is behind the realization of this movie. And allegedly, it was said that there were people that were talking about the set stage of the movie as the NASA East.
Yeah, absolutely.
And that is also a mystery to me. So I really would love if you could further provide us your view about how come that the U.S. government changed completely its approach on Kubrick.
Das ist sehr interessant, weil es tatsächlich Vorwürfe, aber nicht von offizieller Seite gab. Es gab Druck von der Air Force, dass bei Dr. Strangelove ein Disclaimer am Anfang gezeigt werden musste. Bei einigen DVD-Blu-ray-Editionen ist der noch da. In meiner Analyse sage ich, der Disclaimer hilft der Wirkung des Films ungeheuerlich. Nach dem Motto, the lady doth protest too much. Also wer behaupten muss, dass es nichts mit der Realität zu tun hat, wenn die Air Force das behauptet, dann muss es ja wohl was mit, sonst würden die ja sich nicht so anstrengen, diese Behauptung aufzustellen. Also es ist in der Tat so, dass die Air Force wohl Druck ausgeübt hat, aber Kubrick war sehr glücklich darüber, das in den Film aufzunehmen, glaube ich. Es ist auch so, dass bestimmte Kommentatoren gesagt haben, das sei ein anti-amerikanischer Film, der die Position der Amerikaner im Wettstreit mit der Sowjetunion schwächt. Aber ich glaube nicht, dass das sehr weit gegangen ist, diese Kritik. Ich glaube, dass diese Kritik nur von einigen Leuten in bestimmten Situationen vorgebracht wurde, aber nicht auf breiter Fläche. Die Sache mit NASA ist tatsächlich so, dass einer von den Beitragenden zu unserem Sammelband Stanley Kubrick New Perspectives hat das sehr genau analysiert, dass tatsächlich Kubrick was aufgebaut hat, was parallel lief zu den Entwicklungsprozessen bei NASA. Und da gab es dann eben auch diesen berühmten Besuch, wo die NASA-Leute zu Kubrick kamen, NASA West meets NASA East. Und dass viele von den Firmen, die für die NASA gearbeitet haben, auch für Kubrick gearbeitet haben. Also ich glaube, dass die Kritik von offiziellen Stellen an Dr. Strangelove letztendlich sehr limitiert war. Ich glaube nicht, dass das sehr weit ging. Und NASA hat, glaube ich, in 2001 auch eine Chance gesehen, ein bisschen positive Publicity zu kreieren. Also NASA hatte, es gibt Mitte der 60er mehrere Umfragen, ob das eine gute Idee ist, was NASA da macht. Gut, John F. Kennedy, der Heilige, hat es vorgeschlagen, dass wir jetzt einen Mann auf den Mond bringen. Aber was ist mit Rassenbeziehungen was ist mit den Riots in Watts und anderen Städten in den USA? Was ist mit Unterstützung für die Armen im Land? Müssen wir das Geld wirklich in den Weltraum reinschießen? Also es war gar nicht klar in Umfragen, dass Leute unbedingt glaubten, dass was NASA macht, eine tolle Sache ist. Und ich glaube, NASA hat in der Zusammenarbeit mit Kubrick auch eine Möglichkeit gesehen, indirekt ein bisschen Publicity für sich selber zu machen. Und umgedreht, und das ist, wo ich zu meinem Thema wieder zurückkomme, hat NASA natürlich ungeheure Publicity für Kubrick gemacht. Alle Raketenstarts von weiß ich, Gemini bis Apollo waren riesen also Ereignisse im Fernsehen und in den Medien. Und jedes Mal, wenn wieder mal eine Rakete gestartet ist und es so viel Aufsehen im Fernsehen gegeben hat und ein neues, zum ersten Mal wird dies und jenes erreicht, zum ersten Mal eine Mondumrundung und all diese Sachen. All das hat MGM in die Werbung für den Film 2001 eingebaut. Man sieht, wenn man die Werbung über Jahre verfolgt, sieht man, dass in der Werbung nach 1968, nach April 68 oft Verweise auf das drin sind, was Apollo gerade erreicht hat. Um zu sagen, was wir in dem Film zeigen, passiert in Wirklichkeit. Aber wie gesagt, umgedreht funktioniert es natürlich auch, dass NASA durchaus viel Kritik ausgesetzt war für oder die amerikanische Regierung für Geldverschwendung, für ein unsinniges Projekt, dass die auch wiederum von dem Film profitiert haben. Also ich würde da durchaus eine gegenseitige Befruchtung, nicht nur im Produktionsprozess, sondern auch in der Vermarktung sehen.
Da schließt sich ja so ein bisschen auch der Kreis mit der Frage zu den Produktionskosten, weil es gibt ja dieses schöne Statement auch, dass die NASA quasi tagtäglich das Budget verpulvert hat, was Kubrick für den gesamten Film in 4 Jahren zur Verfügung stand, also die 10,5 Millionen Dollar. Unsere Zeit ist leider um. Wenn Sie aber jetzt noch Fragen haben für weitere Anmerkungen, Kommentare, noch was von Peter Krämer wissen möchten, diese einmalige Chance nutzen möchten, wir machen jetzt eine kurze Umbaupause. Peter Krämer ist dann auch noch im Foyer. Und dann gibt es gleich jetzt die Vorführung von Killer's Kiss. Und deshalb meine letzte Frage natürlich an dich noch mit einer Bitte um eine kurze Antwort. Warum hast du dich für Killer's Kiss entschieden?
Es ist ein Film, den sieht man sehr selten. Es ist bei offiziellen Veranstaltungen schwierig, Fear and Desire zu zeigen, weil Kubrick den Film meiner Meinung nach ungerechtfertigterweise als Amateur-Lehrstück abgetan hat.
Und das machen wir dann nächsten Monat, darf ich kurz einpflegen, am 19. Mai, Fear and Desire, auch hier an dieser
Ich habe mich nicht getraut, den vorzuschlagen, weil ich dachte, dann kriegen sie Ärger.
Das hat Ralf Michael Fischer dann getan und der wird am 19. Mai hier zu Gast sein, 20.15 Uhr.
Weil das finde ich einen ganz ausgezeichneten Film, der aber problematisch ist in seiner Stellung auch gegenüber der Kubrick-Familie sozusagen. Jan Harlan redet nicht gerne über Fear and Desire. Und deshalb habe ich mir gedacht, dann nehme ich halt den nächstbesten Film, den Leute sehr selten sehen. Und das ist eben Killer's Kiss. Das ist noch ein eigentlich in Eigenarbeit gemachter Film, wie auch Fear and Desire. Ist eigentlich ein Amateurfilm. Aber sehr professionell gemacht, mit sehr, sehr wenig Geld, aber Geld, was trotzdem viel Geld war, 70.000 Dollar, glaube ich. Das war 20 Mal das durchschnittliche Jahreseinkommen eines Amerikaners. Winziger Bruchteil vom Hollywood-Film, aber natürlich 20 Mal ja, das durchschnittliche Jahreseinkommen. Also dann auch wieder nicht billig. Es machen viele Leute mit, die bei Fear and Desire mitgemacht haben und die auch später noch bei Kubrick mitarbeiten. Und es ist eben ein sehr hochstilisierter Film. Heute nennt man sowas Film Noir. Damals hat niemand das Film Noir genannt, bis auf ein paar Franzosen. Aber in Amerika hat das niemand so genannt. Ich würde es einfach als Krimi sehen, als Großstadtkrimi und auch ein Boxerfilm, was eben zurückgeht auf Kubricks ersten Film, den er überhaupt je gemacht hat, den Kurzfilm, der heißt Day of the Fight über einen Boxer. Es ist also ein Film, der ganz in der Entwicklungslinie von Kubrick vom Fotografen, da hat er eine wichtige Geschichte über einen Boxer gemacht, dann wurde daraus ein Kurzfilm und jetzt haben wir eben einen langen Film und ist ein Film, der sehr verwirrend sein kann, der sehr viele Fragen offen lässt, was aber viel mit Zensur zu tun hat. Das hat viel, oder Selbstzensur, das hat viel damit zu tun, wie Hollywood damals Geschichten erzählt hat. Und ich habe die Unterlagen gesehen für Killer's Kiss in der Production Code Administration, also die Selbstzensurbehörde. Und da wurde ihm doch einiges gesagt, was er nicht tun könnte. Aber wenn man sich den Film anguckt, ist man erstaunt, wie pervers der eigentlich ist. Wo ja der Production Code genau verhindern sollte, dass Sexualität und Gewalt auf so unglaublich intrigante Weise verwoben werden. Das sollte genau der Production Code verhindern. Aber Kubrick hat in diesem Film das sehr, sehr in den Vordergrund gerückt, auf ungeheuer perverse Weise. Und ich denke, dass das den Film besonders interessant macht.
Ja, ganz herzlichen Dank nochmal, Peter Krämer. Danke fürs Kommen, danke für die Diskussion und für den Vortrag.